Welcome to issue 150 of Critical Encounters, a podcast about Marvel Champions, a living card game by Fantasy Flight Games. Here, we take a good look at that most critical piece of the game, the encounter sets. We'll discuss those poorly understood characters, unfairly labeled villains, and their various plans to shape humanity and benefit the planet, as well as the so-called heroes intent on thwarting them. I'm one of your hosts, Daniel, and joining me tonight is Steve. Dear Steve, how are you?
I'm feeling good. How are you feeling? 150. I feel good.
150, Steve?
Yeah.
Did you ever think, those nigh almost 4 years ago, 150?
No. No, there was a point somewhere around like 8 where I wasn't so sure about it. But after we made it to like 12, I felt pretty good. And then, then we started hitting those big numbers. And now 150 is a big number, but it's still not our anniversary because we're gonna wait until we hit that 154, 155 until we do our anniversary.
And that'll have been 3 years or four.
It'll be 3 full years and we'll be going into our fourth year. We'll be starting volume 4.
Wow.
Yeah.
150, and who do you think is not here to enjoy it with us? Because, Steve, do you remember last year where Mike had a birthday that lasted week after week?
I do remember that.
He's done it again. He didn't even leave a note on the fridge.
Yeah, he's just gone.
I don't know where he is.
Took all of Thor's brew right out of there and off he went. So
that's actually the worst part. Although maybe that's the best part.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely
having heard that.
It's good for us.
Having heard that song.
Oh, that was fun. You know what bothers me the most about this multiple weeks of Mike's birthday is I don't think we once said happy birthday to you or me on this show in the 3 years we've been on the air.
Nope, never. And I'll tell you what, we don't take off for week after week.
Nope, I'm here every single show.
I think that's true.
I haven't missed a show. Oh, I take it back. There was that one solo show that Mike did, Born in Denial. I don't know what was going. on that week, but for some reason, Mike was the only one available.
You are, without a doubt, the most steadfast of us all. Mike pampers himself at like some spa island, and every once in a while, I have to bow out for things.
Yeah, I think I'm the only one who knows how to push the record button.
So, there is that.
Yeah, I got to be there here. Because last time I left you guys alone, it got pretty out of hand. So people could go back and listen to our villainous shows if they want to hear about those. So.
Yeah, there were a couple times.
Yeah.
So maybe it's best you took the Thor brew.
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Well, man, but we got a birthday present, Steve.
We do.
It's just not for Mike, and he didn't give it to us. But you know who did? Berg04.
Oh.
Wrote in with another 5-star review, Steve.
Wait, I have to say it. Daniel, what's on your mind tonight? There we go. Keep going.
That's on my mind. This present from Berg04. The title is great. Don't be like me. Listen now. 5 stars.
Yeah.
I slept on this podcast for far too long. If you were asking yourself, how could there be a whole podcast episode about a Marvel Champions modular set? Just take a listen. Charming, informative, and just plain fun.
Oh, I love it.
Isn't that great? Thank you, Berg04.
Yeah. The charming, informative, and just plain fun. I think that's what we're hitting. We're going for. I feel like that's what we're going for.
I feel like each of us takes one of those things. I'm pretty sure I'm charming.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm pretty sure you're informative.
And Mike's just plain fun.
When he's here, he's just plain fun.
Yeah. I hope that we mix that up throughout the show.
I guess maybe.
Yeah, once in a while.
I mean, I just don't have anything to offer but charm. So,
well, that's not true. You're also just plain.
Cheers, man. Oh, good. Plain and charming. Well, we're here to finish up our talk about Sandman.
Yes, we
are.
Last
week was great. Finding those journals, talking about what he's up to, what he's trying to do, and
kind of where he's
as a villain. I love him. Yeah.
So, before we get to it, I have a pop quiz for you.
For me?
Or you?
Steve, what is my record on quizzes in this show?
You have gotten every one right that you have gotten right.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay.
I feel like the story of my life was in the board game lawyer quiz where...
where I completely stole most of your answers.
You snaked my answers. Yeah.
I'm really good at improving on other people's successes.
There you go.
Or near successes, yeah. There you go.
The world needs those people too. All right, so what's your pop quiz? Hit me.
Okay, so in the very first encounter between Sandman and Spider-Man way back in 1963.
Number four, right? Spider-Man
number
four.
Number four, yep.
Okay.
Spider-Man, quote unquote, won the fight. Okay. The truth is he didn't. Eventually, Sandman gets free and everything like that. But to the reader, it sure looked like Spider-Man won. And what trick did Spider-Man use to defeat Sandman in that first issue?
Huh.
How did he defeat him?
Are his comic powers more or less in line with him in the movies?
Yes, almost identical.
Okay.
If not exactly the same.
I think the way you could defeat like a sand form would be to try to throw it into a wind tunnel of some sort. That's my guess. High winds.
Okay, you're somewhat close.
Okay. Okay.
You're kind of there. Do you want a hint? What sort of handheld wind tunnel could Spider-Man have used?
Oh, doesn't Thor's hammer make a tornado?
Oh no, Thor's not involved.
Okay. Thor's
this
not
is
involved.
A more this is a more domestic sort of solution.
A spray bottle? No. a handheld wind tunnel?
Mm-hmm. Reverse wind tunnel.
He vacuumed him?
He vacuumed him up. Yep. Got out the old Electrolux and just sucked him right up.
Oh my God, that is so great.
Yep.
Yeah,
I think that's pretty funny. So, which I think provided Spider-Man's charm back in the day, right? These quirky solutions to
quirky, quick thinking. Yeah.
Yep.
God, we need to make that custom card for the heroes.
Spider-Man's
neutral,
vacuum.
A neutral Electrolux.
Yeah, Aunt May's Electrolux. Boop, boop. Right. So, yeah, I thought that was a good little piece of trivia. So.
Wow, that is hilarious. Okay.
Well, we don't have a vacuum card, but we have some other ones, so let's look at those cards.
Let's go. Let's finish up his encounter set. How many are in this second half here, Steve?
Second half. We have 13 cards, 7 by title.
Okay, so that's kind of a small encounter deck.
Yeah, it's not bad. And we're going to add 2 modular sets to this, right?
Always City and Chaos, right?
Yep. And the other one we can pick and choose.
Pick and choose. All right. So, pro tip, is there a modular set with like 30 cards in it? Because that might be the one you want.
Yeah, because we know he's milling cards. He wants a smaller deck. Yeah. Yep.
All right. So then the best thing is like, who's that minion from way back in the day that mills you? Is that Electro?
Electro. Yep.
He'd be a tough cookie with Sandman. They'd be
and they're buddies. They're buddies at some point. Yeah. Yeah.
Aren't they in the same modular set in the core set?
Sandman shows up in Rhinos. They're both Sinister Six.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, they'll hang out in this box too, right?
Yep. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. But anyway, we digress. 4 of those 13 cards, Steve, are little minions called Sand Clones.
Okay.
Now, they seem like they seem a little harmless when you look at them. They are a minion, of course, one scheme, X attack, which X should always make you a little nervous, right?
Yeah, I should.
3 health, no traits. I can't think of any cards or minions that don't have a trait.
Other than Scorpion, I don't think any of them are traitless.
So are these things not, you know, enthralled by Sandman or even anything like that or creatures?
I believe they are Sandman. Like if you look at the art, he's got himself all over the place and he just
and they are clones. Okay.
And they just sort of rise up out of him and they fight until you smash him up.
All right. I get it. All right. Well, anyway, we digress. Steve, you know what X is? X is equal to the number of sand counters on city streets. So if this shorty shows up round 1, where the game has just been set up and there's 4 on there.
Yep.
He's got a 4 attack. That is for a tiny little minion. This guy can hit hard.
Yeah, and if you have been ignoring city streets because you're like, oh, I'm going to wait until it gets to a 6, and then I'm going to clear it all off with this one big ally I've been building. It's like hitting for a 6. So,
right.
Yeah.
Now, of course, 3 health, you just have to look at him sideways and it's over for him. But,
right.
You know, that's turning your attention. And Because of that, he's got a great When Defeated, Steve. When Defeated, resolve the Surging Sands ability on city streets.
Okay, that's good.
Which makes sense because you like blow him up into a pile of more sand, right?
Right, yeah, you're burying whatever's around him in more sand. Yeah, it's perfect. Yeah, I think these are great minions. It's super thematic. I think it's great. The art looks nice.
Yeah, it's cool. Upon first look, you almost like, is that Groot?
Yeah, almost.
Almost. But yeah, I really love this kind of signature minion. I feel like a lot of the villains have that, right?
The one thing I feel like maybe they could have is guard. Like, because they're surging around you. They're sort of made of him. I sort of feel like I've had enough games where these guys come up like on the last turn and you can just ignore them and just pound on Sandman. Sure. I almost feel like they should have guard, but they don't. So,
well, or since they're Sandman, they should add their health to him.
Yeah. If you don't kill them. Yeah. There's more you could do there, but I still think they're a fun little minion.
They are fun. They're fun. And that's really only a last turn kind of.
Right.
Chicanery you can do, because like you don't want to leave these things around. Not really.
The other option is to make sure that there are zero sand counters on city streets,
right?
And if you have city streets at zero, you start the villain phase, Sandman's going to attack you. If you take any damage, you're going to put at least one token out. So if you cannot take damage from Sandman, they remain a zero, right? But
and then you just keep them in front of you.
Yeah.
Although, then you just thin out his deck more. Oh, it's complicated.
It is. It is. So the one thing for Sandclone is it has no boost icons.
Oh, gosh.
That's kind of sad.
I forgot to mention that. Yeah.
Yeah.
It should at least have the little star that says reveal it.
Yeah, that'd be pretty cool.
Because then they're hitting for a lot.
Then they would come up.
They could be hitting for a lot.
Yeah, they would have a chance to actually hit you before they die because of 3 hit points. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe during playtesting, that would have been a little too.
Too much. Yeah, that shows up with an 8 or something. Yeah.
And you don't have Squirrel Girl? Sorry.
Well, yeah.
All right. Well.
All right. So speaking of like adding hit points to Sandman, let me tell you about the next card. Okay. Kind of like that. All right. It's Sand Form, and there are two of these attachments. They have the condition trait, and they say attach to Sandman.
Okay.
Forced Interrupt. When you would deal any amount of damage to Sandman, discard Sand Form instead, resolve the Surging Sands ability on city streets. Mm. They have a special boost, reveal this card. So it's a defense shield.
Yep.
Any amount. So you're going to try to only put 1 damage or 2 damage on him, right? You don't want to waste a big 5 hit.
It's a glorified tough, right?
It is a glorified tough, but it's a tough that once you blow it up, triggers Surging Sands.
And you have to blow it up.
Yep.
No way around it. I like that card.
Yeah.
You know, like these villains, they have their signature minion, and they always have a signature attachment, right?
Something. Yeah, kind of pretty usually.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's take a look at some treacheries that our good friend brings. One is called Sand Smash. When revealed, if you're an alter ego, resolve Surging Sands, and then this card gains Surge, Steve. Hmm. Wow. If you're revealed as a hero, Sandman attacks you with +1 attack. I will bury you. Steve, I'd rather be in hero, right?
Yeah. Well.
Maybe. Well, maybe. I don't know.
It depends, because in hero form, depending on you've already been attacked, you've already used your defense action up to prevent the damage. So now he hits you for +1. You take indirect damage and you still trigger Surging Sands.
Yeah, that's true.
But it doesn't surge. But it doesn't surge.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, this has 1 boost icon on it, at least. And there's, 2 of these Sand Smashes?
2 of those, yeah.
Yeah.
I like it. It's a simple card.
Yeah. I like the alter ego, how it's just sort of like, you're an alter ego, so you're not digging the streets out.
Right. He's building up.
Yeah, a little bit of sand, and then something else. So.
You might go to Aunt May's, but he's still working.
Right. He's still working.
It's sort of like Mike on his birthday, and you and I are here in the lair.
All right. We're still working.
Yeah, we're still working. We're heroes. Well, villains.
Yeah. Hard-working villains.
So what's harder than a sand smash, Steve?
Oh, a sand storm.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a treachery. There's only 1 of these.
Thank goodness.
When revealed, deal X indirect damage among players, divided as you choose, where X is equal to the number of sand counters on city streets. If there are no sand counters on city streets, place 3 sand counters on it and shuffle this card into the encounter deck. Two boost icons. All right, there's a lot there to dissect.
Yeah. Okay.
Deal X damage among players where X is equal to the number of sand counters on City Street. So if there's four or five, you got to split that up.
And here's where my question last week about can an alter ego take indirect damage? This is where that would happen.
Definitely would. Yep.
Yeah. So, or where it could happen. All right.
Right.
Wow.
And yeah. And then if you have been clearing the streets of sand and there aren't any on it when this comes up, you're going to put three on it and you shuffle this one back in. So it has a chance of coming up again.
I kind of wish it said if there were fewer than three.
Oh, three or fewer or something like that. Yeah.
Bring it up to three and shuffle it back in. But
because there's a good chance. Yeah. Just like with the sand clones, the timing might be that you just got hit for one indirect damage and there's one token on it. So you're only going to take one indirect. Yeah, that's true. Still, I mean, okay. You know what sandstorms, however, can lead to?
I do. I do, Steve. They can lead to a pretty catastrophic sand slide.
Oh, okay.
All right. One revealed. Place two sand counters on city streets, then resolve its Surging Sands ability. Wow. If at least one Sandman card was discarded this way, you are stunned. Wow. And it's got a special boost. Resolve this card when revealed. All right. All right. This is not a boost-heavy encounter set.
No. So the interesting thing with Sandslide, or even like Sand Smash, is, well, Sandslide, I guess, it's you're going to put two counters on it, and then you resolve the Surging Sands ability, which the very first thing the very first thing you do is you put another one. So minimum, you're milling three cards off the deck. So
yeah.
And you could get a Sandman card, right? So you're looking in the bottom left corner, does it say Sandman or not? And you could get stunned.
It's kind of a mean card.
Yeah. Look, the art's got a bunch of those spider people we were talking about.
Do we know who those other two are?
That could be Spider Gwen on the left, maybe like a version. I don't really know who they are.
I don't recognize them at all.
No. No one's got
someone write in and tell us who are the other two spider warriors on Sandslide.
Yeah.
One appears to have two red braids, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the other could have shorter hair, or is that up in a bun? Try to tell.
I think it's up in a bun.
Looks like it's up in a bun.
With the white and red.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Well, we'll have our minions look into that.
Yeah.
Send a report. But Steve, these guys are always trying to do something. They always have
some kind of side scheme. Oh, he's got two. Let me tell you about this Tidal Sands side scheme.
Okay.
I don't know if he's really doing anything on this side scheme or if it's just sort of happening. Tidal Sands, it has two flat threat on it, two boost icons, and a hazard, but has this when revealed. Place X additional threat here, where X is equal to the number of sand counters on city streets. So you're looking at zero to whatever. So it could have a bunch, and then since it has a bunch, that hazard stays out and more cards are being revealed.
You know, if you're one of those risky heroes, it's like, you know what, I'm going to try to rush this, or I'm going to prioritize not dealing with the streets, or you don't have a lot of allies. Like, you know, Mike never makes allies in his decks.
Right.
So he's going to have to figure out a way to clear that stuff with his hero. You might just try to rush the whole thing, and this could be bad.
Yeah.
You could have that extra card for a good long while. Oof.
Yeah, hopefully that's the case. There's a good picture there, too. It looks like Black Widow, some spider person, and somebody else are about to just get crushed.
Just crushed. Yeah. Oof.
Well, that's right. Not the only...
That's not. He's got a couple other tricks up his sleeve. He's got two dirt traps in the deck, Steve. A beige billow floods the streets around you. Everywhere you turn, Sandman awaits. This is a weird one.
Okay.
It starts with a single threat.
Huh.
And ends with a single threat. It has three boost icons, but here's the fun of it, Steve. Not only does it have the crisis symbol on it, but when defeated, resolve the Surging Sands ability on city streets. Resolve it again!
Oh, there it is. Okay.
Why not just say resolve it twice?
I think they probably want it to completely resolve. Who knows?
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the wording's a little odd there, but I love this is so great as a crisis with one threat. Great. it's so it taunts you, right? It's you have to get rid of it because he only has a 9 threat threshold, and you might be putting out acceleration icons tokens because he's going through his deck. So you have to get rid of this with just that little bit, that just that one, and then he buries you twice. Yeah, it's like Admiral Akbar's favorite card here. You know, it's a trap. Yeah.
You almost definitely want this for its horrible boost icons. So I'm glad it's got 3.
Yes. Yep. So that those are all the cards in his set. So the one thing about his whole set is you could play several games of hit against him and never see these because they get discarded with Surging Sands. So they don't come up as a boost. Oh. They don't come up as an encounter card. They just keep getting discarded, right? So you could play a few games where you never see Tidal Sands because, oh, you just lucked into the fact that it's always been discarded.
Well, I never thought of that.
When I play, I seem to get Dirt Trap every single game, though, no matter what. So,
well, there are 2 of them. It's likely. So,
mm-hmm. Yep.
Steve, I like this set a lot. I think it's a great intro to the box.
Yeah, it's a ton of fun. It has a lot of interesting mechanics, something new with the whole Surging Sands thing.
Yep. I'm a big fan of environments.
Yeah, that just changes the whole thing with just one card.
Yep.
The 2 modulars that they want you to use are pretty fun because they give you that, like, rhinos running around town, and they want you to be an alter ego. So you're an alter ego. You can't be attacking because you're dealing with all these other obligations, and there's just something about you're back in the streets or you're dealing with, you know, just sort of this odd thing going on.
Yeah, it's great. Good Lord. A lot of fun.
So give it a letter grade.
I will give it a letter grade. I think that this guy is an A, and I think he's an A for 2 reasons. One, he's just interesting by himself, but I really think the modular set you add can just change him a lot. Like, you can accelerate his acceleration thing. You can kind of slow that down and have some other type of mod sets that distract you in other ways. I just think that there's a flexibility to him.
That's
really neat. I love how he changes how you deal with allies. I'm an ally guy. Like, I love decks with allies and playing a lot of them. He just sort of makes you think differently about it. It's not like a counter ally deck. It's just think differently about him. And I love that.
Right, because you can still put your indirect damage on your allies to suck up the attacks.
On you, and on, and I like that there's something else for your allies to do.
Yep.
You know, with the environment, with Surging Sands. I think it's great. I'm going to give it an A. I know you don't give grades, but if you did.
I think you're on target. I agree with you. You're on target.
Yeah. Great, a great set. He's. I also like to test decks against this one. And you're like, people used to do that with Ebony Maw, like test their decks, and then I did that too, and now when Sandman came out, I was like, oh, this is a great one, because it sort of taxes you in a number of ways.
Yep. Some other modular sets to use, I think, instead of the down-to-earth one, because that's the one where we talked about maybe last week, 2 weeks ago, where it's really like obligations, and you're flipping to alter ego, and you're doing stuff like that. Things like the Ransacked Armory, where you can put some attachments out on the sand clones, so they stick around longer, or minion heavy sets. Maybe the pirates. Badoon pirates or Badoon are around. So you have to spend more time attacking them. You can't use your attack set as much to dig out.
Going old school, like Masters of Evil.
Yeah, that's just a set.
We had mentioned Electro last week.
Mm-hmm. It's
Hydra. Yeah, you could do a lot of things.
Yep.
I wonder what people what mod sets people enjoy playing. Maybe they could tell us.
Oh, maybe they could. Daniel, Mike's not here, so you're gonna have to do his part.
Well, I want to clear something up though. So maybe we weren't clear last week at the end.
Oh.
Our question was like, where in the world is the best place you've gone that has sand? Maybe you didn't come across. When I asked it. Feel like we worded that a little differently last week.
I've been to the beaches in the Mediterranean. I would say that those places.
Me too. One time, Puerto Rico, like Caribbean, man. It's just that's beautiful. But anyway, you tell us that. Where in the world's the best place you've gone that has sand? And please tell us how you like to play Sandman. What mod sets do you add to it? You can tell us by emailing us at criticalencounterspod@gmail.com. We are Critical Encounters on Facebook. You can find our YouTube channel by searching for Critical Encounters Podcast. And on Discord, we are Vardane, Wandering Took, and Big Foam Loaf. If you like our show, tell your friends. If you don't like our show, tell your enemies. Sandman, take us out.
If you want to get to me, you got to go through me.